returning ATT&CKcon speaker, Daniel Wyleczuk-Stern.
All right, thanks everyone. As Adam said, I'm Daniel, and I'm going to be talking to you all today about how to use ATT&CK to measure what matters and how to do things in the right order. Anytime you work on something, you're choosing to not work on something else. Therefore, when you're working in a cybersecurity organization with limited resources and motivated adversaries, it's important that you make deliberate decisions to maximize your return on investments for security projects. And I believe you can use ATT&CK to really help make those kinds of decisions. So a little bit about me, Daniel Wyleczuk-Stern, currently in Washington, D.C. I currently am a security engineer at Snowflake, before that Praetorian, and before that the U.S. Air Force. I have quite a few cats, but I have managed to subdue them for this talk, so hopefully they shan't be bothering us. So what am I going to talk about? I'll go over some fundamental assumptions and principles that I have about cybersecurity and risk. I'll discuss some of the problems that I've seen when making decisions, some of the books and principles that I've read that have helped me formulate my hypotheses and the way I operate with risk. So we'll just talk about the main idea with ATT&CK and how it helps, and then work through an example that really shows the power of using ATT&CK for quantitative risk analysis. And then also some devil's advocates, disclaimers, counterarguments, et cetera. So what are these assumptions that I'm operating from? One, I believe security is technical and applied risk management. The goal isn't necessarily risk elimination. As a security leader, your job is to spend just enough to reduce risk to an appropriate level. The hard part is that our field is not really good at quantitative risk management just yet. When I say quantitative risk management, I mean using numbers to drive your decisions as opposed to things we've commonly seen, such as low, mediums, highs, et cetera. This means using numbers and saying this is measurably more effective or measurably less effective than this and making your decisions based off of that. Below, you see some common formulas used in risk. They're not super complicated, but they can be pretty hard to actually figure out how to actually calculate them. So why is it so hard? Well, one of the things that I've seen so often is when people do risk calculations or examples in books, they come to the thing like risk is likelihood times impact. Well, how do you measure those kinds of things? It's left as an exercise to the reader and it's pretty hard to figure out. So how do we actually go about estimating how much risk we're actually going to reduce by implementing a solution? And then how do we ensure standardization across projects so that we can measure risks across a suite of portfolios or a suite of products that we're working on and make strategic high-level decisions? Luckily, I think these problems have all been solved, and it's just a matter of applying the theories to the work that we're doing. So these three books I would highly recommend. The first, How to Measure Anything, also has a cybersecurity edition, talks just about that, how to measure anything. Talks about measurements, estimation, sort of the intangibles of business, as it says. Thinking Fast and Slow is another bestseller that really talks a lot about a lot of things, but one of the things it highlights is probability and bias, and humans are naturally bad estimators. And then Engineering Trustworthy Systems talks about quantitative risk management and cybersecurity. There's a number of books on threat modeling and risk management, like FAIR, that I would recommend. So from these, I drew a couple of guiding principles. A lot of these are summarized from How to Measure Anything. Essentially, we have more data than we think we do, and you need less than you think you do in order to reduce uncertainty and drive improvements in your quantitative risk analysis. Especially risk quantification is possible through understanding your threats and doing threat models and threat profiling. So you see these kinds of improvements with consistencies and frameworks when it comes to application security. They use frameworks such as Stride and Dread to drive actionable, repeatable, and defendable threat models that you can use to reduce your risk and make strategic decisions. However, how do we actually apply this to enterprise security? And now we get to the main idea, which is use ATT&CK, tactics, techniques, and procedures in your threat models. Sounds really simple and really easy, but the rest of the slide will sort of talk through how you actually do that and some of the benefits you'll get from that. So how do we get started? Well, one of the things that's very hard to do with threat models is get those kinds of measurements for likelihood and impact. Luckily, when using ATT&CK, a whole world of data opens up to us to get that level of granularity. So one example is from sort of people who have measured it already, such as the folks at Rapid7 who published an ATT&CK frequency diagram. So if you're ever looking at a threat model and you're wondering, I wonder what the likelihood of an attacker using PowerShell is, well, you have a number right there. And you may say, well, maybe that's not accurate to my organization. That's true most often, but still one of the founding principles, one of the principles of how to measure anything is that some reduction in uncertainty is likely better than where you were before. Or if you do have a unique scenario, luckily there's tools such as TRAM from MITRE or RCAT, I'm not quite sure how to pronounce it, which allow you to pull attack techniques from intelligence reports. And from there, you can begin to collect measurements yourself and really start to get measurements of likelihood and probability. Similarly for impact, somebody has already solved this problem. And if you're looking at, well, what is the impact of something happening? That kind of data already exists and it's not too hard to go find it. Again, it's probably not going to be accurate to your specific organization, but it's better than where you were before, where it was just a critical risk. Now we actually have numbers and we can begin to measure things and calculate return on investments. So I thought the best way to show this would be with an example. Let's say you're an organization trying to look at deploying a privileged access management system for your Active Directory or passwordless logons for your single sign-on solution. The first costs $50K a month and the second $5K a month. Additionally, you've recently had a pen test where the auditors came in and said, hey, you have a lot of passwords, you know, attackers are brute forcing single sign-on portals, we recommend this. So your CISO is looking at the second option because it's cheaper and you've got auditors who are saying it's a good idea. However, with threat modeling and measurement, we can use ATT&CK to help avoid these kinds of recency biases. So what we're looking at here is a tree threat model, the kind of threat models that you'll see in books like Engineering Trusted Systems and a couple of other threat modeling solutions. Essentially, what we're saying here is that the privileged access management system would help us reduce the likelihood of an attacker obtaining access to a privileged account. From threat modeling, we decompose this into four nodes or four leaves, which we see at the bottom. Brute force, credential dumping, access token manipulation, and credentials and files. And I've correlated those with their associated attack technique. Now, because we've done this, we're able to now get measurements from these and therefore determine an overall probability that somebody would obtain access to a privileged account. Well, how do we do this? Some of it can be done from measurements, such as from a pen test or from compliance audits. And some of it can be done from estimates and research, such as credential dumping. We can have our cyber threat intelligence folks pull reports and collect data and say, what is the likelihood of this happening? From this, we're able to get the overall probability of about 12%. Again, this isn't going to be very, it's not 100% accurate, but it's more accurate than we were before, where we were saying this is a low risk or a medium risk. We now have actual quantitative numbers, which we can use in our calculations. So what about after we implement this system? Whether it's through estimates or through a trial, we're able to remeasure and re-estimate. And you know, through this simulated talk, we get a reduction down to about 2%. So 12% to 2% is pretty good. It's about a factor of 10. But that doesn't really tell us the whole story when it comes to risk. We also need to know the impact and harm. So obtaining access to a privileged account isn't necessarily harmful in and of itself. This requires us to build out our threat model a little bit more and say, what is the attacker's actual goal? In this case, we're looking at the threat model of compromising PCI data. Now, our leaf node obtaining privileged access is now a leaf node in this threat model. And we can see that obtain access to a privileged account in the bottom of the screen. From our threat model, we've determined that there's a couple of ways that somebody could obtain access to PCI data, whether that's compromising the PCI database or compromising the website with a Mage Card style attack. For those who don't know, the Mage Card style attack is a class of attacks where attackers are able to insert malicious code into websites and steal credit card data as customers place orders. So from our additional measurements and estimates, we calculate that without any systems, without the PAM or the passwordless logons implemented, we have about a 12% chance of a breach of PCI data occurring. Using again, the estimates from before with about maybe 70,000 records, we're saying we have a $10 to $50 million harm if this were to occur. Now with expected harm, we just harm times probability, and we have a range of about $1.2 to $6 million. Now, what happens after we implement the privileged access management system? We redo our calculations, and we can see that the expected harm has dropped to 200,000 to 500,000. Assuming a cost of about $50,000 a month, we now have a range for our return on investment. This may seem like a pretty high and wide range, and you're right. However, what we're looking at isn't necessarily what is the return on investment, but what is the return on investment relative to other projects so that we can make decisions about what we're going to work on and what we're going to work on first. So now let's look at the passwordless single sign-on solution. We have an and now where an attacker has to obtain email addresses and passwords and MFA. Again, we're able to collect these through measurements and estimation. And we say that the likelihood of somebody obtaining access to an account is 1.2 times 10 to the negative 6. So pretty small probability. This occurs because they have to bypass MFA, and we also have some pretty good password requirements in our scenario. So what about afterwards? Afterwards, we say that the likelihood of phishing and brute force being successful, probably have to find some sort of bypass or maybe some kind of service account, has dropped significantly. And we went from 10 to the negative sixth and 10 to the negative fourth, which is a very, very large reduction in terms of factors, right? But how does that affect the impact of the overall risk? So now we've expanded the right side of the tree, compromising website via maze card style attacks. In this scenario, we're saying about 15% are developers and 5% are admins who would have the privileges, if they were compromised, to be able to push malicious code in the same area. Now, afterwards, we see that the right side of the tree has dropped from 10 to the negative 7th or so to about 10 to the negative 11th. However, because the left side of the tree is so dominant in the probability calculation, this hasn't changed the expected harm at all. And assuming a cost of $5,000 a month, we actually have a negative return on investment when we do these calculations. So what was the sort of point of this exercise? We were able to obtain pretty, not necessarily accurate, but pretty realistic numbers in terms of probabilities and impacts, and make a decision relatively quickly about which project would yield a higher return on investment and really reduce risk in a quantifiable way that we know now we're making the correct decisions about where to allocate our funds and allocate our time. And ATT&CK has helped us in terms of pulling up those likelihoods, and the data is readily available to us. So isn't this just threat modeling with ATT&CK? Yes, it is. But ATT&CK really helps with the threat modeling calculations to make a quantitative risk analysis and really help with those measurements and calibrated estimates. You may say you can't just make up numbers. Well, in this scenario, these are measurements and also calibrated estimates. And I highly encourage you to read How to Measure Anything, as it talks about how to do estimation. And you may say this example was too simple. And it was, but I was constrained on time. And also, we're not trying to get an exact return on investment. Our goal is to compare projects to determine where we would get the most return on investment and allocate our resources there. So this, you have to invest time in calibrating your people. I say estimates, and I want to separate that from guesses. And How to Measure Anything really talks a lot about how people are pretty bad at estimating probability, and we have to be trained on how to become good estimators. And I recommend starting with folks like Cyber Threat Intelligence, as they're going to be the ones who have to do a lot of these kinds of estimates and have to pull from reports to draw conclusions. And this can also be pretty hard. Threat modeling in and of itself is a task that a lot of mature organizations struggle with. And when you add on estimations and measurements and calibrations, it can become even more difficult. And it's something that at my current organization, we're still learning and improving on. So I think I'm good on time. Are there any questions?
Great presentation, Daniel. That was fantastic. You got a lot of interest building up in Slack. And as usual, it's welcome back. It's always great to have a familiar face. Big question here is, you know, you've done a lot of research and a lot of good highlighting of how you kind of forecast problems and kind of like you said, see opportunities, see, you know, problems and address them. But how do you calibrate that later on with, you know, once you've instilled and kind of installed, you know, these practices, these policies that you kind of forecasted, how do you calibrate that back towards, you know, real world operations, comparing, you know, what you saw versus what's happening to kind of, you know, address some of those uncertainties that you highlighted?
So I think what you're asking is, how do we sort of keep our models up to date? Again, that's one of the benefits of ATT&CK. A lot of folks or organizations will sort of store like, hey, what's our detection probability for this technique? What are our risks or our risk mitigations that we have applied to this? Along with that, we can keep our model of what do we think is the likelihood for this occurring and what are the systems that we have in place for that? So again, something like password brute forcing, we can say, well, we have, you know, our MFA solutions, we have our passwordless login solutions, and we can keep our repository of what do we think is the likelihood for this technique occurring, and even mapping that back to certain systems where maybe we have, you know, an old legacy database where when we match the technique with this database, it has this probability. And then we match it with our single sign-on solution, it has a lower probability. But then when we do these lookups, we can say sort of where what the probabilities are for those systems.
Okay, that makes sense. And then, you know, just kind of, you mentioned this is a very notional, very simplistic model, just for the sake of kind of highlighting this process. But, you know, for those starting out that were really interested in kind of pursuing a similar approach, you know, what is your advice towards, you know, selecting, you know, the subset of all of ATT&CK or even beyond ATT&CK to kind of build as a foundation for these models?
Sure. So this is more of a top-down approach versus a bottom-up approach. So I wouldn't say start with ATT&CK. I would say start with systems and risks. So let's say you're looking at implementing a new website or a new database. Those are the kind of business decisions that should drive this risk analysis. You shouldn't say, I want to start with cloud TTPs and look at my cloud threats, because that's the risk modeling should be driven top down by your systems versus bottom up by your threats when it comes to determining sort of where to look first. That's my belief.
That makes a lot of sense. And I think, like you said, ATT&CK gives you kind of the coverage to understand like where those problems may lie, as well as, you know, just kind of the perspective on the bigger picture there. I think another great question I saw just come in from Slack was, you know, regarding your models, is there any way to kind of materialize and actually, you know, manifest tangible, actionable results from those uncertainties? I think someone mentioned like Monte Carlo simulations or things like that to kind of actually quantify those.
Yeah, how to measure anything talks a lot about, and I think also thinking fast and slow, talks about using Monte Carlo simulations. So when you get these estimates and these ranges of probabilities, you should really start with a range. So I said 10 to the negative one. You could maybe more accurately say, well, we think it's 5 to 15%. Then when you plug these into an Excel spreadsheet and you can do some Monte Carlo simulations, you'll get a range of risk that will sort of bubble up. It can get a little complicated. That's why, like for this scenario, and when you're first starting, I recommend just keeping it simple and seeing if you can get a decision that is clear without having to do those kinds of estimates. And again, how to measure anything talks about how to get the value of additional data when it comes to doing your measurements. Like these problems are solved. Like just read books, and I encourage you to explore the areas of risk and risk quantification.
Well, thank you very much and great presentation. You definitely have a couple of questions building up in Slack, so definitely hop over there to address those. But with that, I'm going to turn it over to Adam.
Yeah, and thank you so much, Jamie and Daniel.